You glad he's risen today? Now, would you ever think that a Savior who died but did not raise from the dead would spell doom for each and every one of us? As we're going to read and find out in our sermon, a dead Savior cannot save anybody. But aren't you glad he rose from the grave? Father, we love you. We thank you for this day. Lord, we are so excited to celebrate your life today. And Father, because of that, we can have eternal life if we would but accept the gift of your death, burial, and resurrection from your Son, Jesus Christ. We are so thankful for a man who loved you so much that he was willing to die and be obedient to your will. But he loved us so much that he took that journey to the cross so that we might have a relationship with you and everlasting life in heaven. Father, we thank you today for so many things, for your grace and your mercy and your kindness and your forgiveness and your friendship and your guidance. We could go on and on thanking you for who you are, what you have done for us, what you're currently doing, and what you will do. Lord, my prayer today is if there is someone here today that is not sure of a relationship with you, God, how I pray that the Holy Spirit would do that work today, that they might recognize that they are a sinner, and that there is no way they could unlock the gates of heaven on their own. And that they would recognize that you died on a cross, shed your own blood as the only possible sacrifice to please God for the wages of our sin. Lord, I pray that we would see souls saved today. I thank you for each and every one that's here. Father, I pray that in everything we say and do, you would be pleased with our worship and that you would receive all the honor and the glory that you are so due. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Gary?
One of the hymns of praise the most appropriate to Easter is found in your hymnal 270, Christ the Lord is risen today. Let's stand as we sing it together. Christ
Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Sons of men and angels sing. Hallelujah. Raise your joys and triumphs high.
This morning, I want to welcome you to North Baptist Church. It is certainly a privilege to have all of you here with us today. If you are a first-time visitor, it is certainly an extreme honor to have you worshiping with us this morning. I hope that you will enjoy your time here. Hopefully you received a packet of information when you walked in the door, and if you would fill that out and drop it in the offering plate here in just a few minutes, we would certainly appreciate that. But we're so glad all of you are here this morning. Quickly, by way of announcements, keep an eye on your bulletin for all of the activities of this week. You'll see tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock, we have a ladies' Bible study. And ladies, we would certainly appreciate it if you could come. See your way to be here tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock for Bible study. Tuesday morning, men's prayer time at 8:30. Ladies' prayer time at 10. All of our regular activities on Wednesday. And then you will see there is... Saturday, April 2nd, there is dinner and a movie for the teenagers. So if you have any questions about that, please see Pastor Aaron, and he can give you the answers you need. Also coming up on next Saturday is a bridal shower for Michaela. And the ladies that are in charge, if you are going to come, would like for you to sign up out on the back bulletin board, and so that they make sure that they have plenty of food and things. If you have any questions about that, please see Donna Beamer, and she can give you the information you need. Just before the choir sings, I want to read to you this morning out of the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 15. And the Bible says in verse 20, "But now is Christ risen from the dead, and become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, afterward they that are Christ's at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Regular offering, we would like to invite our young kids, if they would help us please for a little bit and head to the back and grab a little bag there. We're going to collect our kids' coins. If you have any spare change, pennies and nickels and dimes and quarters and Visa and MasterCard, we want to help our young kids go to camp this summer. It's about $250 a person. And if you can help us with some spare change, we would certainly appreciate that. So ladies, if you would, please.
Thank you.
right, young people, if you would, bring your bags back up to the front, drop them in the basket there. Now, that song takes me all the way back to Walnut Street Baptist Church in Lebanon, Indiana, about 1974, 1975. Who remembers Rolled Away? Who knows the motions to Rolled Away? Do I know it in Japanese? No. Okay, I need some help up here. All right, come on, birthday girl. Come on, if you know the motions. Who else knows it? I need some help. Sue Clark, you know the motions? Anybody else know the motions? Carol Forbush? Probably not. All right. We're going to do Rolled Away. Oh, let me take that. Thank you, young man. Do you know the motions? Birthday girl. Today is her birthday, by the way. Happy birthday, Lisa Buckley. All right. Are you ready? Here. Happy birthday. All right. For your birthday gift, we have to do Rolled Away. I don't know if I remember the motions. Do you? Okay. All right. You ready? Rolled away, rolled away, rolled away. Every burden on my heart rolled away. Rolled away, rolled away, rolled away. Every burden on my heart rolled away. Every sin has to go 'neath the crimson flow. Hallelujah. Rolled away, rolled away, rolled away. Every burden on my heart rolled away. Very good. Very good. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Bob, where are you? Work on her shyness a little bit, would you? Get her out of her shell, all right? Fellas, if you would please come, let's have our morning offering. Again, if you're visiting with us, if you would fill out that information card, we'd just love to have a record of your visit, all right? Okay. Russ, if you would please, sir. Thank you.
you, Joyce. Hallelujah, Christ arose. Some of you may have heard me asking Pastor if he knew how to sing Rolled Away in Japanese. It reminded me, it wasn't the 70s for me, it was the late 50s, I hate to admit it, but it was, and Twin Cities Baptist, where I was growing up, actually, even before that, there was a predecessor church to it, and Burton Baptist was the name of it. Some of you may know that. And our youth director came back, and he'd been stationed in Japan during the war, and he learned how to sing it in Japanese, although some of the words like Yokohama and Omaniwa sound an awful lot like English that's been, you know, put in a different format. But if you ever want to learn it in Japanese, I don't think I'll go there this morning, but I'd like to wish all of you a happy Easter and a great Resurrection Sunday. Thanks for being with us. We're going to sing hymn number 22, We Will Glorify, followed by 304, Crown Him with Many Crowns. Shall we stand together as we sing, please?
We will glorify the King of Kings. We will glorify the Lamb. We will glorify the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Lord Jehovah reigns in majesty. We will bow before His throne. We will worship Him in righteousness. We will worship Him alone. He is Lord of heaven, Lord of earth. He is Lord of all who live. He is Lord of all the universe. All praise to Him we give. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. Hallelujah to the Lamb. Hallelujah to the Lord of Lords, who is the great I Am. Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthems round, a music by its own. Awake my soul and sing of Him who died for thee, and hail Him as thy matchless King through all eternity. Crown Him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious in the strife for those He came to save. His glories now we sing, who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to bring, and lives that death may die. Crown Him the Lord of peace, whose power a scepter sways, from pole to pole that wars may cease, and all be prayer and praise. His reign shall know no end, and around His pierced feet fair flowers of paradise extend their fragrance ever sweet. Crown Him the Lord of love, behold His hands and side, those wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. Oh, hail Redeemer, hail, for Thou hast died.
Thanks for that great singing. Please be seated. And now, Sarah, if you would, come and sing for us, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Let's go to the book of Mark, if you would please. Mark chapter 15. I would encourage you, if you can this evening, if you don't have any other plans, I would love for you to join us tonight at 6 o'clock here for our evening service. We're going to do something a little different. We are going to look at the last day of Jesus Christ through the eyes of a Jew who happened to be in town for the Passover. And it is going to be a fascinating yet sobering and very realistic look at the very last hours of Jesus Christ. So I would certainly invite all of you to be here tonight for that. Mark chapter 15, and let's start in verse 16. Mark 15, verse 16, and the soldiers led him into the hall called Praetorium, and they called together the whole band. And they clothed him with purple, and plaited a crown of thorns, and put it above his head, and began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they smote him on the head with a reed, and did spit upon him, and bowing their knees, worshipped him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple from him, and put on his own clothes on him, and led him out to crucify him. And they compel one Simon, a Cyrenian, who passed by, coming out of the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to bear his cross. And they bring him unto the place Golgotha, which is, being interpreted, the place of a skull. And they gave him to drink wine mingled with myrrh, but he received it not. And when they had crucified him, they parted his garments, casting lots upon them, what every man should take. And it was the third hour, and they crucified him. And the superscription of his accusation was written over, "The King of the Jews." And with him they crucified two thieves, the one on his right hand and the other on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, "And he was numbered with the transgressors." And they that passed by railed on him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ah, thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days, save thyself and come down from the cross." Likewise also the chief priests, mocking, said among themselves with the scribes, "He saved others, himself he cannot save. Let Christ the King of Israel descend now from the cross, that we may see and believe." And they that were crucified with him reviled him. And when the sixth hour was come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which is, being interpreted, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And some of them that stood by, when they heard it, said, "Behold, he calleth Elijah." And one ran and filled a sponge full of vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him to drink, saying, "Let alone, let us see whether Elias will come to take him down." And Jesus cried with a loud voice and gave up the ghost. And the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And when the centurion which stood over against him saw that he so cried out and gave up the ghost, he said, "Truly this man was the Son of God." There were also women looking on afar off, among whom was Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James, the less, and of Joseph and Salome, who also, when he was in Galilee, followed him and ministered unto him, and many other women which came up with him unto Jerusalem. And now when the even was come, because it was the preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly unto Pilate and craved the body of Jesus. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead. And calling unto him the centurion, he asked him whether he had been any while dead. And when he knew it of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. And he bought fine linen, and took him down, and wrapped him in the linen, and laid him in a sepulchre, which was hewn out of a rock, and rolled a stone under the door of the sepulchre. And Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of Joseph, beheld where he was laid. And when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James, and Salome, had bought sweet spices, that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun, and they said among themselves, "Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre?" And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he saith unto them, "Be not affrighted. Ye seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. The title of our message this morning is, And the Scripture Was Fulfilled. Father, we thank you for the wonderful time we've had in your house so far this morning, singing praises unto your holy name. We thank you for the fellowship between believers. We thank you for the opportunity to give back that which you have so generously given to us. We thank you for the ministry and song. But Father, now as we turn to the preaching of your word, God, how I pray that we would listen very intently with open minds, open hearts, open eyes, and open ears to what thus saith the Lord. God, I pray that just for the next few minutes we would be able to cast aside every care that waits outside this door, and that we would do our absolute best to draw closer to you, that we would try to have a better understanding of exactly what you went through and why. But Lord, we know it's because you loved us. Father, we thank you for that. May you receive the honor and the glory for this time in the preaching service. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you were a criminal back in this day, and you were found guilty of said crime, and if you were sentenced to die by crucifixion, it was the law that you would carry your cross to the place of crucifixion, or certainly the cross beam, and certainly Jesus Christ was no exception to the Romans and the Jews. He was nothing more than a criminal. He left Pilate's hall bearing his cross, but he could not continue. And so the Roman soldiers, as they had the power to do, could pull anybody out of the common crowd and enlist them into the army, or whatever the soldiers asked them to do. And they found a man named Simon of Cyrene to carry the cross for him. And when you consider all that our Lord had gone through, from his betrayal and denial and arrest and everything that had happened up until this moment, it is not surprising that his strength failed. Yes, we know he probably could have called legions of angels to do his bidding, but he was willing to bear the suffering on our behalf. And when you think about this, when we see Jesus Christ here, yes, he was 100% God, but he was 100% man. And what we see in this instance is Jesus the man was not strong enough physically to carry that cross. Did Jesus fail? Absolutely not. He is showing his humanity. And after everything that he had been through, physically being tortured and abused, he could not bear the weight of that cross. But aren't you glad that he was more than strong enough to bear the weight of our sin as he died on that cross? You know, there is a special higher act in carrying Jesus, carrying this cross, because the guilty person, this criminal who was found guilty, that was part of their punishment. They had to carry their cross. It was a sign of guilt. But guess what? Jesus Christ was not found guilty, nor was he guilty of anything. Pilate and Herod, I find no fault in this man. Folks, guess what? You and I are the guilty ones. And Simon of Cyrene was carrying that cross on our behalf. Isn't it interesting that Simon Peter, the bold, the brash Simon, got on to the Lord and said, Lord, I would go to prison with you, and I would die with you. But it was Simon of Cyrene, not Simon Peter, that came to the aid of the Master. There's speculation as to the exact place of Jesus Christ's crucifixion. That doesn't matter. We know it was outside of the city walls on a hill called Golgotha, Mount Calvary. It was outside of the city walls, which was considered to be a place of rejection, and it was there that he died for the sins of the world. It was a customary thing for someone who was going through an exceptionally painful death to be given a narcotic drink to help deaden the pain. You can see that in Proverbs 31 and verse 6. But Jesus Christ refused it. Why on earth would he refuse this, for lack of a better word, for our common day language, morphine is basically the equivalent here. Why would he refuse this narcotic drink? Because he wanted to be in full possession of his faculties as he finished his Father's will and as he finished the work of our redemption. He would enter fully into his sufferings on our behalf. He would take no shortcuts. He refused this cup of sympathy so that he might better drink the cup of iniquity. If you read through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you will not find in any of those gospel writers accounts of this. You will not find a description of the crucifixion. Perhaps it's not necessary because all of the people in that day had probably seen or been witness to a crucifixion. It was such a detestable thing that it was not even mentioned in decent society. But suffice it to say that crucifixion is the most horrific kind of death that has ever been invented by man. The guilty person would always wear a placard, whether in their prison cell or on their way to the crucifixion. They would wear a placard, a sign that showed what their guilt was. Pilate wrote the description of Jesus Christ's guilt, which hung over his cross. This is Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. There were many soldiers that guarded the Lord Jesus Christ every step of the way. They were busy beating him and tying up his hands. They put a crown of thorns on his head. They put nails in his hands and a nail in his feet. But little did those soldiers know that they were also fulfilling prophecy as they gambled for our Lord's garments. You can see that in Psalm 22 and verse 18. What's amazing is not only were soldiers accompanying him on this journey in case he would try to escape, but the Roman leaders so hated Jesus Christ because they thought they heard this man is coming who thinks he's a king and he might overthrow the Roman government. And so the Romans hated him. The Jews hated him. The Sanhedrin, all the Pharisees, all the Jewish leaders hated him because he claimed to be God. And so they all followed him all the way to the place of crucifixion. And they mocked him in front of all of the bystanders. They mocked him. And so why wouldn't the bystanders do the same thing? They just got caught up in the frenzy. Let's notice how they mocked him. I mean, now, among everything else, we can add mocking among the people to the sufferings of Jesus Christ. They mocked him as prophet. Look at chapter 15 and verse 29. And they that passed by railed on him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ah, thou that destroyest the temple and buildest it in 3 days." They mocked him there as prophet. Look at verse 31. They mock him as the Savior. Likewise, also the chief priests, mocking, said among themselves with the scribes, "He saved others. Himself he cannot save." And then look at verse 32, they mocked him as the king. "Let Christ, the King of Israel, descend now from the cross that we may see and believe." And they that were crucified with him reviled him. But at noon there was a miraculous darkness that came over the land, and all creation sympathized with the Creator. It was a miraculous darkness. It was not some natural phenomenon, as some might want to call it, a sandstorm, which happened in that region of the world. Some tried to say it was an eclipse, but you can't have an eclipse when you have the Passover and the full moon. It was during this time of darkness that God was trying to say something to the people. Because certainly the Jews would go back to their days in Egypt. And that ninth plague was what? 3 days of darkness. Then the Passover and the death of the firstborn. Now we have 3 hours of darkness at the Passover and God's firstborn son dies. We read in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 5, we all know this verse, God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. This was the most compelling, emotionally trying moment for Jesus Christ through this whole journey, because it was at this moment when the Bible says God is light and in him is no darkness. God could not be there at that moment with Jesus Christ during the darkness, because it was at that very moment that Jesus Christ was enduring and bearing the darkness of our sin. We read in Mark 15, 34 down to 41, we read some of the statements Jesus Christ made from the cross. Folks, I'm all for you watching some of these Easter shows on television. But please watch them with a grain of salt, because they're not accurate. They're not. But when we look at the statements Jesus Christ made on the cross after everything he went through, the first statement that he made on the cross is absolutely unbelievable, because we see the mercy and the grace of our Lord and Savior in spite of everything he's been through. Because he's hanging there on the cross after being beaten and mocked and scourged. He was not fed. He was not allowed to sleep. There were false trials. He was denied. He was betrayed. Yet he looks out over the people. He talks to his Father and he says, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. Can you imagine? He is showing mercy to a bunch of people that hate him and rejected him and falsely accused him. He said, Father, forgive them. He wasn't thinking about himself on the cross. He was thinking about his audience. And there's no doubt in my mind that when Jesus Christ was hanging on that cross and he said, Father, forgive them, he was referring to the Jews and the Romans and everyone else in the crowd. But I'm also convinced that when Jesus Christ said, Father, forgive them, he was talking to the people that were sitting in North Baptist Church today. Folks, I hate to tell you, we are sinners in need of forgiveness. So here we see the forgiveness of our Lord. We see the mercy of our Lord. Then in his next statement that he makes, we see the grace of our Lord, always thinking of others. He happens to strike up a conversation with one of the thieves next to him, who the Bible just told us was reviling him a little bit ago. But praise God for deathbed conversions. The thief looks at him and says, Jesus, remember me when you enter into your kingdom. And Jesus looks over at him, nails in his hands and feet, blood dripping everywhere, crown of thorns, and he says, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Grace. Even in death, Jesus showed mercy and grace. His third statement, he looks down at Mary and he says, woman, behold thy son. And then the darkness came and there was silence on the cross, because it was at that moment that Jesus Christ was being made sin for us. As the song was just sung, Christ became sin for us, 2 Corinthians 5:21. He who knew no sin became sin for us. But then it was at the ninth hour, after the 3 hours of darkness, the 3 hours of silence, that Jesus Christ expressed the very agony of his soul, not his physical sufferings. He wasn't the least bit concerned about his physical sufferings. It was the agony of his soul when he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He didn't cry out to his Father.
He cried out to God.
You know, it's interesting because as was customary, the people didn't understand his words. They thought he was crying out for Elijah. Just as there was darkness in the air, there was darkness in the hearts and the minds of the people who didn't understand. Is there not darkness in our world today, full of a world full of people who don't understand the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Then we come to another statement he makes. I thirst. Isn't that something? We're talking about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who met the woman at the well and said, you keep drinking out of that well and you will always be thirsty. But if you drink of the water that I have to give, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, you will never thirst again. Come to the fountain of living water. Jesus as God never thirst. Jesus as man was thirsty. A soldier goes, gives him of all things to drink vinegar. And then Jesus Christ makes his final two statements. It is finished. Did a sermon 2 or 3 years ago entitled, It Is Finished. I would encourage you at some time to go home and just think about what was finished. What did he mean by that statement? What exactly was finished? You will find a number of things in that simple statement. And then his last statement. And again, he goes back to his Father. Not God, but his Father. Because this one, ladies and gentlemen, this last statement, he had done everything for people. Up until his very last breath, he asks for forgiveness for all of the people. He saves a dirty thief right next to him and says, you'll be in heaven with me today. But at the very last, just before Jesus Christ gives up the ghost, he makes a very personal statement from a son to a father. He said, it is finished. And then he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Jesus said, it is finished. He said, Father, I've done everything I can do. I've done everything you've asked me to do. The rest, God, is up to you. So he cried out to his Father. He said, I've done everything you've asked me to do, and now I'm asking you to take care of me. I am trusting everything to you, Father. Into thy hands I commend my spirit. We need to understand something. Jesus Christ was not killed. Jesus Christ was not murdered. He laid down his life willingly, voluntarily for each and every one of us. If you go to John chapter 10 and verse 11 or John chapter 10 and verse 15, it tells us that the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. If you will remember one of the trials, Pilate, with assuming he had some authority, which he had none, especially when going up against Jesus Christ, Pilate was mad because Jesus was not responding to his questions. It's like, your life's on the line, buddy. Why don't you respond to me? And Pilate says, don't you know that I have the power to take your life? Jesus looked at him, and if you'll allow me to paraphrase, he said, you have no more power to take my life than a man on the moon. You can't do anything, Pilate, because I will lay down my life when it's time. Jesus Christ was not he was not murdered, nor was Jesus Christ a martyr, because he willingly gave up his life for you and for me. There were two remarkable events that happened at his crucifixion. There was an earthquake, and the veil in the temple was rent in two. That veil in the temple separated man from God. It was the law that didn't allow men to go past that veil into the Holy of Holies. It was only for the priest. But with the death of Jesus Christ, he entered for the whole world a new and living way in which we might have a personal relationship and a time of worship with the Lord Jesus Christ. The sacrifices were no longer necessary. And then we had an earthquake. Interesting. We read in the Old Testament of an earthquake that occurred upon Mount Sinai when God was giving Moses the law. Now there's an earthquake at the moment the law is being fulfilled in Jesus Christ. The curse of the law would be removed. In Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 9, it talks about the resurrection. The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 4 and verse 25 that Jesus was delivered for our offenses, raised again for our justification. Have you ever thought about what that verse means? He was delivered for our offenses. He died because of my sin. He died to pay a price I couldn't pay. He shouldn't have been on that cross. I should have been on that cross, and you should have been on that cross. But he died for my offenses. And then it says he was raised again for our justification, so that we could be seen as righteous and heirs in the family of God. Folks, a dead Savior, as we talked about, cannot save anybody. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is every bit as important to the gospel message as his sacrificial death. And the beautiful thing about the resurrection is that it proves that Jesus Christ was who he claimed to be, the very Son of God. You know, he told his disciples that he was going to be raised from the dead, and they really didn't understand what he was talking about, nor did the ladies fully understand, because we know that when they went to the temple, they went with what? Anointing spices, embalming spices. They were going to finish the burial procedure on the body that Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea had started. Then we read in Mark 16 where the ladies go early on that third day to the tomb. It was dawn. Sun was just coming up. And they were surprised to see that the tomb was open. The stone was rolled away. Hallelujah, rolled away. Then they were surprised to be greeted by two angels. Those angels were sent by God to be there waiting for those ladies. And then the ladies were even more surprised at the message of those angels. He's not here. He's risen. He's alive. And he is going to Galilee to meet you. Mary Magdalene, who had personally experienced the forgiveness of Jesus Christ, runs to tell Peter and John and the rest of the disciples, the tomb's empty, he's alive. And after she told the disciples, who, as we know, if you read, you'll find they didn't buy her story one bit. And if you'll read in the New Testament, you'll find New Testament history, women were not allowed to be witnesses in trials because they were not considered trustworthy. But folks, let me tell you, the women here were the first preachers of the New Testament. They had a message to preach. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that we'll not go there, but they were preaching. And they had a message to preach. You know, folks, it's one thing to hear the message of Jesus Christ. Sunday after Sunday, week after week, month after month, year after year, if you've been raised in church, it's one thing to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. But it is something altogether different to meet him personally and to have a personal relationship with him. Jesus Christ in somebody else does you no good. None whatsoever. You must have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. He died for you personally. You need to meet Him personally. Don't take somebody else's word for it. The death on the cross was the only sacrifice that was acceptable to God. His resurrection from the dead proves that He was God. And that because of that death, burial, and resurrection, you and I could live the rest of our days having sweet fellowship with Jesus Christ, knowing that He loved us so much that He died for us. Folks, I hope you're here today and you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you have a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. If not, we would love to show you today from God's own word how you can know beyond a shadow of a doubt that heaven can be your home and that Jesus Christ can be your Savior. You can try all day long to work your way to heaven. It won't happen. The Bible says our righteousness is as filthy rags. Folks, even on our absolute best day, we would fall embarrassingly short of God's glory. The only way to heaven is through the cross and through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I have no desire to embarrass anyone, but I have a great burden for every person here that they know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. And I would ask you, if there's a shadow of doubt regarding your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, if you're not sure that there's ever been a time where you realized and recognized and admitted to the Lord, I am a sinner, and that sin will keep me out of heaven. That's why Jesus died. If you can't recall a time where you asked the Lord to forgive you and that you believe that He died on the cross for your sins and you asked Him to be your Savior, this is a wonderful time. The gift has already been given, but folks, you have to receive the gift. You can accept it or reject it. It's that simple. But you need to understand, if you reject the Lord Jesus Christ and His death, there will be consequences to pay that are completely out of your control. If you deny the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, then at the great white throne judgment, Jesus Christ will deny you, and hell will be your home forever. So let me ask, I don't want to embarrass anyone, just slip up your hand. If you're not sure, say, Pastor, pray for me. I'm not sure of my salvation. Folks, the Bible says now is the accepted time. Now is the day of salvation. Anyone, just slip up your hand. Pastor, pray for me. I'm just not sure. Maybe you know I'm not saved. Just want to pray for you. Anybody like that? Heavenly Father, how I pray that every person in this room knows what it means to be a Christian. And that they are claiming Christianity based on God's word and not what they personally, subjectively believe. Because that would be a huge mistake. Father, I pray that if there's anyone here today that's not saved, that before they leave this place today, they would talk to me, talk to someone. We can open up God's word and show them just how much the Lord Jesus Christ loves them. Father, have your will and way in this invitation. I pray, Lord, that you would do the work in the hearts and lives of your people today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Here.
Hymn number 251, Lead Me to Calvary, 251. Let's stand and sing verses 3 and 4 together.
Show to me now. now the empty tomb, lead me to Calvary, lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget. Forget Gethsemane, lest I